Burak Aydin is the director of outreach at the Kurdish Policy Research Center here in Washington, D.C. He joins me here on the set. Kevin McKiernan spent 15 years traveling amongst the Kurds, wrote a book, The Kurds, and I lifted a passage from it because I want you to kind of talk about it. This was his assessment. The world's largest ethnic group without a state of their own, the Kurds saw their historic lands divided by colonial powers early in the last century, and their recent history at the hands of the Turkish, Iranian, Iraqi, and Syrian governments has been dismal. Do you agree? And is that, does that encapsulate? I mean, when you look at 92%, I mean, that's a huge number.
Absolutely.
Is that the reasoning behind this?
Well, Kurds are a population of 40 million people. And, you know, it's one of the largest group of people that is stateless. As you mentioned, they're divided into four different countries: Turkey, Iran, Iraq, and Syria. In Turkey, we have nearly 20 million Kurds. In Iran, we have nearly 10 million Kurds. In Iraq, about 6 million. And in Syria, about 3+ million Kurds. So it is a sad fact that Kurds have been colonized by these four countries after the World War One, after the decision of the British powers.
And so now you have them making this break, and you see not just Iraq reacting angrily, you see these other countries, and obviously you've just kind of given us an overview why. Give me your sense about the hostility about this, and where does it go from there?
Well, Turkey is actually, Turkey and Iraq, of course, they're against this referendum. Of course, Iran as well. It's mainly because of the fact that they're afraid of the possibility of this referendum inspiring the other parts, the Kurds in other parts of Kurdistan, you know, asking for independence from, let's say, Turkey or Iran. But they've made it very clear, at least the Kurds in Turkey, that they're not going for independence. In fact, they're more integrated into the Turkish society, and they want to be equal citizens of Turkey. So I think this is a very empty fear that Erdogan, for example, has. So again, Iran as well. I mean, the Kurds in Iran, they're very oppressed, but so far they haven't really demanded any freedom or independence or anything like that. The most they asked from the Iranian government has been federalism, again, you know, under the constitution of Iran. So,
well, you just said the word constitution. Let's talk about Iraq and its constitution, because it's become a kind of a linchpin in the argument.
Absolutely.
Here.
So Abadi uses the constitution whenever it's convenient to him. So according to the Article 140, they had to hold a referendum in the disputed areas in 2007. And the constitution was formed in 2005. Despite the requests from the Kurdistan Regional Government to Baghdad, this referendum that was supposed to be held in 2007 was actually never held. Of course, this created a lot of tension between Baghdad and Erbil. And the other thing is that Article 121, which was the revenue issue again, the Iraqi revenue, 17% of the Iraqi revenue had to be given to the Kurdistan Regional Government, but they haven't received a single penny since 2013. And up until 2013, they weren't actually getting what they were supposed to get from Baghdad. So when Abadi talks about the constitution, he first of all needs to realize the mistakes, the unconstitutional actions that Baghdad has taken against the Kurdistan Regional Government, and then maybe he could use the constitution for everyone in Iraq.
Well, you say actions, there may be continued actions, because they're saying, you know, when it comes to airports there in the Kurdish area, that they're going to close them down on Friday. I mean, there's a lot of threats going
right
around. What do you read into that? And obviously, a vote is just a first step, and this is a first step in a journey. We don't know how long it's going to be. I mean, give me your sense of that as well.
Sure. The president of the Kurdistan Regional Government, Mr. Barzani, clearly said that this is not the declaration of independence. This is just going to start the negotiations with Baghdad. They're going to talk about the amicable split. They're going to talk about the currency issues, the trade issues, and so on, even the borders. So the reaction that Baghdad and Turkey is actually showing here is very unnecessary, because as the president said, the president of Kurdistan Regional Government said, this is not the declaration of independence. So airspace issue, let's say, that Baghdad is trying to impose on the Kurdistan Regional Government. The United States State Department said this is unacceptable. I mean, this is only going to complicate the issue even more. So, and again, we have Turkey on the other side threatening the Kurdistan Regional Government with shutting down the pipelines, the oil pipelines, and starving them to death. I see them as really empty threats, and this is actually showing those countries' hatred towards the Kurds. Obviously, here the president of the Kurdistan Regional Government is ready to negotiate. However, those states, those countries, are not ready to negotiate, and that's where the real problem starts.
Well, divorces are messy, and this one looks like it's going to be just like that. Burak Aydin, thanks so much for coming
in. My pleasure. Thanks.